second speaker is Gennady. Gennady, for those who are not informed, is chairman of U.S. Transhumanist Party, also chief executive of Nevada Transhumanist Party, editor-in-chief of electronic journal The Rational Argumentator, novelist, composer, author, and his last achievement during the recent year was a regular virtual enlightenment salon every Sunday, disseminating a lot of knowledge and organizing a lot of discussions about current topics of transhumanism. So I have the pleasure to give the floor to Gennady.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to present today. I believe we are at an important crossroads in our civilization, and transhumanism provides a path out of the current predicament of civilizational insanity that we are experiencing. So I hope to share some thoughts on how transhumanism can restore civilizational sanity in the near-term future. So first of all, we live in insane times. I think we all recognize this. There are many manifestations of the insanity of our current world. First, there's an unprecedented global pandemic and accompanying restrictions on daily life that we haven't seen in the Western world for centuries in many cases. There has been a surge in crime and violent social upheaval by individuals of various political ideologies, as well as individuals who have experienced additional strain in their material circumstances. There has been extreme polarization into political tribes, for instance, the red team versus the blue team in the United States. And if you don't agree with the entirety of the ideological package of one of these tribes, that tribe will brand you as the enemy. There's no room for nuance, discussion, debate, exploration in the search for truth. There has been a mainstreaming of severe intolerance, which has been unprecedented, at least since the McCarthy era in the United States in the 1950s, where the so-called cancel culture spreads beyond just criticizing or condemning someone for their views. People have lost their jobs. People have been deplatformed from social media. People have lost access to bank accounts, to the means to carry on financial transactions simply because they've held unpopular political views or views that a certain social movement found objectionable. And at the same time, various social movements, many of which might have started for admirable or understandable reasons, have been co-opted by cynical individuals for ulterior motives. Once it becomes apparent that the easiest way to destroy somebody personally or professionally is to merely allege that they are somehow out of compliance with the newly fashionable dicta of these social movements, then of course some calculating people are going to use that precisely to destroy whatever their target individuals may be. At the same time, we're all experiencing shortages of basic goods, different goods at different times and places. It was toilet paper at the start of the pandemic, now lumber and semiconductor chips and other more advanced components are unfortunately in short supply. And with material shortages comes significant and accelerating price inflation. Our infrastructure is being destroyed by a series of natural disasters, many of which are precipitated by destructive climate change. There are unprecedented wildfires in California right now. The smoke from them has inundated northern Nevada for several weeks. And last month, for some of those weeks, northern Nevada was the most polluted place in the world, but that clearly is not the only place in the world experiencing these disasters. Greece, for instance, is subject to severe wildfires right now. New York, Philadelphia have been flooded in unprecedented ways. Hurricane activity is certainly increasing in a manner that would have been statistically very difficult to arrive at prior to the era of climate change. we have an entrenchment of authoritarian regimes in the generally described East, Xi Jinping in China, Vladimir Putin in Russia, Alexander Lukashenko in Belarus have been largely successful in cracking down on dissent over the course of the past year. But the nominally authoritarian regimes are not the only problem. There has been a rise of what I would call social totalitarianism in the West, where it's not the government necessarily that enforces very onerous norms from which no deviation is allowed, but it's a network of private institutions, corporations, social media networks, the legacy media, and even private individuals who might do that at the behest of propagandists who might be aligned with a particular political faction. And yet that social totalitarianism can be as comprehensive as totalitarianism from the top down in the right circumstances for that kind of oppression to arise. And this is not yet the worst that can happen. We have social movements calling for much worse, including active degrowth, undoing the progress of our industrial and technological civilization, or active discrimination, denying opportunities to people simply because they were born with a certain skin color or a certain gender. And by means of their skin color or gender, they're automatically classified as oppressors and their opinions are automatically considered invalid. And there are movements advocating for the destruction of property as a legitimate means of taking out one's frustration at real or perceived oppression, because those movements claim, oh, property is not alive, it can be replaced, but they completely disregard the essential role of property in underpinning this infrastructure of civilization. Without property, we would all be living very poor, hand-to-mouth, hunter-gatherer types of existences. And I'll note, insane civilizations have undermined themselves to the point of collapse before. This painting by Thomas Cole, The Course of Empire Destruction, depicts the sack of Rome in 410 CE by Alaric the Goth. And clearly, there were centuries of cultural problems and mismanagement and poor decisions that led up to the collapse of the Roman Empire. So I think we need to treat this as a cautionary tale. If our civilization continues on its present course that we have observed during the past several years, then the fate of the Roman Empire is not out of the question. So how did this come about? I would suggest that the shift to culture-wide insanity occurred circa 2015 in its most obvious manifestations, but the precursors arose much earlier. And really, the precursors were embedded in this postmodern era that we have been living through. And this current insane period is the final phase, the death throes of the postmodern era. And there's some hope in this, in that the postmodern paradigm is actually collapsing all around us, and maybe it could be replaced by something better. But while it's collapsing, it's trying to take down everything else with it and wreaking considerable havoc in the process. Postmodernism rejects objective meaning and asserts that everything is based on subjective narrative and power dynamics. And as a result, entire societies have fallen into the route of replicating purely convention-based behaviors and consumption patterns instead of focusing on the fundamental physical material prerequisites of the good life, because they didn't have an objective understanding of what those prerequisites would be. So culturally, the populace was encouraged to disregard the objective reality and the state of the material world and instead focus on the glorification of subjective feelings, including increasingly pathological ones. It's the attitude of if it feels good, then do it. And stereotype fostering ideologies have arisen in various identity politics movements, both on the left and on the right, and increasingly polarized resentment of those who are unlike oneself. If you don't have an objective basis of truth to rely upon, then you're going to fragment your society into ever warring tribes. And any notions of purpose, progress, and meaning have been derided as quaint or even oppressive by an academic and cultural establishment that amplified this culture of passive aimlessness and added to the mental and emotional pathologies arising from the loss of firm values. So this situation could not have lasted were it not encouraged by a significant portion of the elite in the Western world. And this has left no capacity for resilience in the face of the pandemic. While external circumstances are generally good, a society can hobble along even on very bad foundations. But with these combined perils, the COVID-19 pandemic, natural disasters, political upheaval, crime, looting, rioting, disruptions to infrastructure, essentially all of the material foundations of the good life are under attack simultaneously. And historically, Western societies and other societies have endured tough times and they've rebuilt afterward because prior paradigms, the modern paradigm, and even to some extent the pre-modern paradigm, didn't have a problem with very quickly restoring what was lost and focusing on that. So a society focused on building, a society that heeds Mark Andreessen's call to build that he issued in 2020, that society can rebuild, but a society that has turned inward upon itself will be caught flailing about aimlessly. So a reliable sense of meaning is needed for many people to avoid insanity and to structure their lives productively, but we can't just return to previous systems of meaning that postmodernism displaced, because there were good reasons for them to be displaced. Many of those previous systems of meaning were religious, communitarian, nationalist, authority-based, and/or characterized by the dominance of some small group, which tended to be oppressive. And those flaws led to the postmodern reaction, but the postmodern reaction in some respects left us even more vulnerable than those old systems of meaning. So transhumanism, fortunately, exists as a newer system of meaning that can inaugurate a new cultural paradigm that has all of the benefits of the modern paradigm, none of the toxicity of either postmodernism or the paradigms that it replaced, and the opportunity to really improve the lives of any individuals who embrace it. This is a system of meaning that is responsive to real-world conditions, focused on their improvement, confident in the feasibility and desirability of material progress through technology, as well as moral progress through rationality. So transhumanism recognizes the societal, cultural, political, philosophical dimensions. It's not just a paradigm that says science and technology will solve everything. We need to think rationally and systematically about the best ways to apply science and technology. And transhumanism provides plenty of goals to achieve and problems to solve. In any area of technological innovation and application, there are so many tasks that individuals can perform. This can completely eliminate a sense of aimlessness or lack of meaning. Furthermore, transhumanism does not rely on any assumptions that are difficult to accept. Nothing needs to be taken on faith. There are no supernatural components to transhumanism per se. It's a non-dogmatic ideology. It does not insist on an unchanging fixed body of knowledge. It's responsive to objective evidence. It's capable of iterative improvement according to the data of reality. And as new information emerges, we can revise our view of the world and our understanding of the best pathways toward an improved state of the world. Transhumanism emphasizes the value of each individual and that individual's continued existence, longevity, and the pursuit of significant life extension are key inextricable components of transhumanism. And transhumanism also supports autonomy and self-determination, however, within the bounds of objective reality based on what science and technology can actually accomplish. Mere declarations of identity are not going to suffice to overcome the problems that plague us all, such as the problem of biological aging and the myriad diseases to which we are subject. That requires concerted progress in multiple areas of technology to actually enable us to transform our identities to be less frail, less vulnerable, less susceptible to these terrible diseases and death. transhumanism is cosmopolitan. It's respectful of an extremely wide range of diversity, but without focusing on group identity politics. We respect individuals as being individuals, and we seek to achieve common objectives that benefit all people, irrespective of their circumstantial attributes. So we don't believe transhumanism is just for one gender or one skin color or one nationality. It's for the entire world. And we need to focus more on what unites us as human beings, as sentient, rational entities, than what divides us. Furthermore, transhumanism rewards those who pursue it as individuals in this world when the technologies to improve the quality of life get developed and spread. There's no need to wait for an imagined afterlife or an imagined future collective utopia, because these advances arrive incrementally, and anybody who helps bring any of the technologies advocated by transhumanists a little bit closer to fruition will benefit from that personally, but will also create positive externalities for the rest of the world. So whether your motives are primarily driven by the benefit of the self or the benefit of others, transhumanism offers many ways to recognize and realize those benefits. So, what are some examples of transhumanist achievements of our time? We've recently had a series of first achievements in manned space flight. So first, SpaceX sent astronauts Doug Hurley and Bob Behnken to the International Space Station on May 30th, 2020. This was the first time a private company had done this. Then Virgin Galactic sent Richard Branson and his crew on the Unity 22 spacecraft on July 11th, 2021. And then just 9 days later, Jeff Bezos on the New Shepard 4 also crossed the Kármán line. And with him were the oldest person and the youngest person as of that time to ever travel to space. So these are impressive achievements. I believe they are epitomizing the spirit of transhumanism, and they should be celebrated accordingly. And we've had great increases in longevity research investments. There was a donation by Vitalik Buterin of Ethereum fame of a cryptocurrency called Dogelon Mars to the Methuselah Foundation. The U.S. Transhumanist Party recently held a virtual enlightenment salon with David Goebel of the Methuselah Foundation, where he explained how the Methuselah Foundation is going to be the steward of this cryptocurrency and help increase its value over time. And this, of course, will also help to finance research efforts. There was an incredibly successful fundraiser organized by Richard Hart, also a cryptocurrency entrepreneur who is creating a new cryptocurrency called the Pulse Chain. And this Pulse Chain airdrop fundraiser raised $28 million for research into strategies for engineered negligible senescence, since Dr. Aubrey de Grey was crucial in ensuring that this fundraiser occurred and spreading awareness of it. And certainly without his work and his tireless efforts for the past 20 years, this kind of major infusion into explicit rejuvenation biotechnology research would not have been possible. And then just during the past week, reports have been published about a new major enterprise funded by Jeff Bezos, the richest man in the world, and Yuri Milner, who has actually been a supporter of longevity initiatives for a long time, called Altos Labs. So it will be quite interesting to see what this enterprise does with extremely large amounts of money by the standards of this field. Furthermore, I would state that the COVID-19 mRNA vaccines are great examples of transhumanist achievements. The Pfizer and Moderna vaccines had the fastest development timeframe in history. They have excellent safety and efficacy records, and they could end the pandemic much sooner than otherwise. The big challenge right now is to persuade enough people to take the vaccines so that some semblance of herd immunity can be developed. But other vaccines are also in development right now that utilize emerging technologies and perhaps they too will make a positive difference in helping bring this pandemic to a conclusion. Now, there are so many areas of technological advancement that could utilize humans of varied skill sets. I'm not going to thoroughly cover them all today, but these areas are as wide-ranging as biotechnology, genetic engineering, life extension research, nanotechnology, artificial intelligence, space colonization, seasteading, vertical farming, economical alternative energy such as solar, geothermal, safe nuclear power, automation of production, which could lead to radical abundance, autonomous and electric vehicles, flying cars, virtual reality and augmented reality technologies, developments in encryption to protect individual privacy, advances in blockchain, cryptocurrencies, smart contracts, distributed autonomous organization, and even artificial wombs, the process of ectogenesis, which can help resolve a lot of the thorny social dilemmas like the abortion issue and also lead to a much safer experience in creating new human beings. So there's a lot of opportunity here for meaning and purpose and productive achievement for people who want to pursue these areas of innovation. There is also a place for aesthetic inspiration, transhumanist art and music. This painting on the left is the City of New Antideath, which I commissioned by an extremely talented painter. Ekaterina Valinakova is specializing in these future cityscapes, spacescapes, future worlds that transhumanists could create and inhabit one of these days. I have some of my musical compositions listed here, which are explicitly transhumanist in terms of their themes, their focus, what they try to depict, including man's struggle against death, the Transhumanist March, which has been featured at this conference before, and my Symphony No. 1, which is subtitled The Contemporary World, and how does a person who seeks a better world deal with the contemporary world? During my message at the end of the past decade, I issued a challenge for humans to compose 100 tonal symphonies during the 2020s, and I hope enough composers take up my challenge, and hopefully some of them will establish a transhumanist musical style that includes elements of hope, aspiration, the glorification of achievement, and productive ways of spending one's time to improve the world. These are all transhumanist ideas, and in the spirit of transhumanism, a lot of great art and music can be created and genuinely enjoyed, whereas a lot of art and music in the postmodern paradigm has been consciously ugly and consciously esoteric, divorced from what most people would find inspiring or uplifting. So it's time to transform that aspect of the contemporary paradigm as well. So to conclude my presentation today, I would like to offer the thought that transhumanism provides the system of meaning and the concrete technological solutions to prevent the descent of our civilization into a new dark age, and instead to inaugurate a bright future for all of humanity. And in the transhumanist movement, we often talk about our civilization being at a crossroads, and there are some wonderful futures we can imagine, and there are some terrible futures that we can imagine. I believe that our current climate of civilizational insanity, if it's allowed to continue for much longer, may herald a new dark age. And it's not because of AI running amok or the gray goo scenario or some other technological disaster. It's because of long-lasting and very predictable human follies that have ruined advanced civilizations before, being very operational right now and continuing to wreak havoc unless a cultural paradigm shift occurs very soon. So with that, I would encourage anyone watching this to join the U.S. Transhumanist Party. If you haven't done that already, go to transhumanist-party.org/membership. you can be a member no matter where in the world you reside. If you reside in a country other than the US, you can join us as an allied member and participate in our internal discussions, our internal votes. We welcome input from anybody who is interested in these ideas. Transhumanism is truly a cosmopolitan international movement for the benefit of all of humankind. And with that, thank you very much for your time and attention today. I would be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Gennady. Please, your comments and questions.
So I'm just a student. Could I ask what means?
Yes, there is no students or professors. All are colleagues.
I'm a colleague. Just to ask, what means exactly transhumanism, like the basic?
Ah, you have to come on our lectures. But okay, Gennady.
Yes. So transhumanism is the philosophy and movement that advocates the use of science, technology, and rationality to overcome the historic limitations of the human condition, limitations such as our mortality, our susceptibility to disease, the incredible fragility of our organism, but also poverty, material scarcity, the numerous constraints that we have lived under since the origin of our species that prevented us from leading fulfilling lives in many cases, and the vulnerabilities of the human mind as well, the propensity toward irrational emotions, cognitive biases, social conflicts. Transhumanism would seek to eliminate wars, eliminate these pointless social upheavals that I described in my presentation. So we seek a more rational, a more humane, a more just world where all humans are able to exercise their full potential for as long as they want to without being subjected to involuntary impositions such as death, disease, and the irrationality of others as well. So hopefully that's a good basic overview. Of course, there's a lot more to be said about transhumanism, but I would encourage you to visit the Transhumanist Party website as well as read the abundance of transhumanist literature that is out there. A great introduction would be The Principles of Extropy by Max Moore, and I'll post a link to that document shortly.
Okay, you're invited to visit our lectures on transhumanism somewhere in November as a part of the course Forecasting and Computer Simulation in Management. There is a block of lectures on transhumanism at the end of the course. And also, you are welcome to join our transhumanist group, Bulgarian transhumanist group. I will show the link almost immediately in a minute. Okay, let's finish first with the questions and comments about Gennady's presentation. Please, other comments?
I believe David Wood has a question.
Yes, David, please.
Really great talk. Thanks. My question is, you've set out the benefits of transhumanism. What are the main obstacles to deeper and faster public adoption of this way of thinking?
Yes, and this is definitely quite worthwhile to think about, especially given how compelling an ideology transhumanism is, and I think would be if more people knew about it and knew about the constructive alternative that transhumanism presents to the major paradigms acting in our culture right now. I think the main obstacle is simple unawareness. That is, most people still don't know the term transhumanism, they don't understand what it means. And it's not that they're predisposed against it. I think their minds are essentially blank slates with regard to that concept. Now, that being said, there may be some challenges in persuading certain segments of the population, just as there are challenges right now in overcoming vaccine hesitancy. And I believe this stems from a kind of increasing cultural skepticism of any narratives that are communicated by establishment figures or figures in positions of authority. I think this stems from the collapse of the postmodern paradigm and often the justified reservations that many people have about whether, say, political institutions or financial institutions or media institutions can be trusted. So in order to avoid that kind of perception with transhumanism, I think transhumanism needs to position itself not as part of the establishment, but as the alternative to that establishment. So right now, a lot of people who are skeptical of established institutions, they don't really have any alternative to those institutions in mind. They're just going to say, oh, I'm not going to listen to what the media tell me. I'm not going to take this vaccine. I don't believe anything they say. All those fact-checking sites, they're just manipulated anyway. But what is in the place of that? In the postmodern paradigm, it's just individual subjective perceptions and whims, whatever they feel like doing or not doing, which is not sustainable either. So what if an alternative locus of meaning could be established, an alternative parallel set of institutions that are essentially transhumanist, that do work, that do use objective understandings of reality and the scientific method, and people see the efficacy of those institutions, and they see that those institutions will not mislead them or abuse them in any way, but rather will offer concrete options for improving their lives, then I think the spread of transhumanism can become quite rapid once people see a way out of this current predicament. And I think a lot of people are frankly desperate right now. They've lived through this pandemic, they've lived through natural disasters, they're seeing all of the upheavals and the political manipulations around them, and they don't really know what to do. So if we as the transhumanist movement can show them some constructive paths, I think that can gain a lot of support.
Okay, thank you. Other questions or comments, Junior?
Okay, Gennady, as always, a great talk, and thank you for this. It's a question, but actually I have two set of questions, two commenters maybe. But they will have to be answered in dialogue mode because one is reliant on the other's answers. Back in the day when I had the time to maintain my blog, of course, a transhumanist blog, I actually published I thought it was a sort of a joke, sort of a, you know, thought experiment, but not really a serious one because I, you know, rationally there is a very clear answer to that. And it was about what if we face a deadly disease, as we all every day face deadly disease anyway, and to this deadly disease we have a cure, which you know, makes you vaccinated in a sense. I'm going to use this for this time around to this disease, but your skin turns green, and would you do it, would you choose this way or another way? And it used to be an obvious, you know, there is a single rational solution there, and I thought this is merely a joke. Of course, my blog was not that popular, so I doubt that anybody read this, but looking at what we have, a real life experiment of sorts, experiment with persuading people, putting them through a rational test for the last less than a year, because it started merely in November, the test itself. It seems like people would choose, in my thought experiment, would choose to be susceptible to the deadly disease rather to be with green skin. So what do you think this, in relation with the previous question, means for our goal of informing everyone?
Yes, and this is quite an interesting question. Of course, I would take the green skin in exchange for a disease cure any day, because ultimately aesthetics about the human appearance essentially have an evolutionary origin as indicators of health. So the only reason why we should be concerned about aesthetics and our appearance is because they communicate aspects of health. And if green skin communicates an aspect of health in this hypothetical world, then green skin would definitely be a fine feature to have, or any other feature that would do that. If I had to be turned into some sort of animate dodecahedron in order to gain indefinite longevity, I would do that as well. But I could see how some people might be reluctant if they feel that their sense of identity or some deeply held aesthetic preference would be taken away or jeopardized by that kind of decision. And I think it is definitely a challenge to persuade people of the contrary. Now, with regard to vaccines, it's interesting because the majority of eligible individuals, once there is sufficiently abundant vaccine supply, do choose to get vaccinated. It's just that there seems to be a stubborn minority of holdouts, about 20 to 30% in the United States.
Actually, there is a great majority of this stubborn 80%.
80%? Wow.
Yes.
And what sorts of vaccines are available in Bulgaria?
All of them.
All of them.
There is plenty. There is not like shortage and stuff like this. But yes. Anyways, you understood the question exactly.
Yes. And I think one way to persuade people, it's a very pragmatic way. It's to say, well, if you're not comfortable with one of these vaccines or one of these technologies, like the mRNA technology, then pick one of the vaccines that doesn't involve those kinds of concerns or reservations. So if somebody is uncomfortable with Pfizer or Moderna vaccines for whatever reason, they could still choose the AstraZeneca or Johnson & Johnson vaccines. And it would be really implausible that all of them, which were developed using different technologies, would be flawed in the exact same way. Now, there are some conspiracy theorist narratives, like the allegation that Bill Gates is putting microchips inside the vaccines, which is just implausible on its face. But I think most people don't really go there in terms of their reasons for reservation. They're more looking for a kind of reassurance that if they do this, this is going to be safe, that they're not being tricked in some way, that they trust the entities that are delivering the vaccines. And I think it's difficult to actually cultivate that trust from institutions that have failed so many times before. And these vaccines are great. They're some of the most effective vaccines in human history. But when we see basic aspects of the pandemic being mismanaged to the point that healthcare professionals don't have masks, at least they didn't have masks at the onset of the pandemic, and there are so many mixed messages that get retracted or revised later on, I think a lot of people haven't developed that sense of trust. So how do you get them to trust the vaccines while still recognizing the genuine problems with the institutions in many countries that have mismanaged the pandemic? Is there a way to disassociate the vaccines from those institutions in people's minds? So I think there are better and worse ways to do it. In terms of incentives, I prefer the carrot approach to the stick approach. I think right now, some countries are embarking on a very dangerous path of mandating vaccinations and threatening people who refuse to get vaccinated. And I believe it should be seen as in everyone's self-interest to get vaccinated. But if the government, especially a government that people distrust, will say, well, you now have to be vaccinated or you'll lose your job, you won't be allowed in many public places, et cetera, then these people who are already distrustful are just going to see this as further oppression, further confirmation of their original reluctance to take the vaccine. And in a culture like the United States, for instance, some of those people will go protest in the streets at best and might even rise up in arms at worst. So we want to avoid that outcome. I think lotteries, rewards for people who are vaccinated, and information, just really communicating how these vaccines are made, what they do, what myths there are about these vaccines, and why those myths are just laughably false and not even capable of being true, that would help. And I think, again, the artistic realm can be brought in. So if there are good graphic designers, good filmmakers, good game designers who could help communicate these ideas and showcase some of the genuine accomplishments behind these vaccines, I think that would help. No single solution, though, no single silver bullet, because persuasion is an individualized task and it works best one-on-one with people. But I can give you one example of a situation that really worked to persuade someone who is fairly close to me. So this is a woman whom I had known for about 15 years, and she actually joined the Transhumanist Party. So she's sympathetic to our ideals, but she was a holdout on the vaccination question for a long time, until her brother, who was a 48-year-old bodybuilder, kind of in the peak shape that he could have been, but he refused to be vaccinated. He caught the Delta variant of COVID-19 and died very rapidly. So that situation convinced her that she needed to get vaccinated. And as unfortunate stories like that emerge too, I think more people will be persuaded. Of course, that's not the way we want them to be persuaded, but in some cases it will be unavoidable.
Okay, so now back to, thank you for this answer. Now back to my second part. And we are going to shift back to transhumanism instead of the vaccines, because it's really about the bigger idea, of course, is the transhumanism. Vaccines are just an experiment here. So, obviously, a larger idea than the vaccines, as transhumanism, will need to be promoted, will need to be communicated. By the way, I don't think that rational information works anymore, but this is just my opinion. And I get the idea, I understand the notion, and certainly Bulgaria is a proof that probably opposition against the establishment is a factor of being opposed to rational moves and stuff like this. Obviously, Bulgaria is such a case for sure. At least this is where, what my observations are here. But also, there is the sense of motivation. And he said the carrot is better than the stick. So in order to persuade mass amount of people, basically the whole humanity, we'll need to put forward positive stimulus, to put everything in a pinkish cover, you know, like the medicines they give to babies. It's not a medicine, but it's a, you know, a candy and stuff like this, right? So we have to babyfy basically humanity to understand it. I understand this. Does this mean that transhumanism is ready to get on its green skin and probably change some of the terms, some of the aesthetics, some of the, even the name of the movement, because I'm not sure majority, but for a lot of people, the main stimulus, or some certain group of people, the main stimulus for joining and believing in transhumanism is are more like negative stimulus, like fear of death, like fear of the crumbling societies and stuff like this. So how do we change and put forward, and are we ready as a transhumanism movement worldwide to change our narrative so that it is more acceptable and maybe even being a little bit deceiving?
So I don't think we need to change our narrative. I think we need to amplify the current narrative, because the current narrative of transhumanism is precisely what is needed to inaugurate this new paradigm of our civilization. And as I've said, I don't think the problem is with the name. I don't think the problem is with the ideas or even how they're being communicated. I think the problem is we're a small movement. There aren't that many of us right now. And each of us has a gargantuan task before us of reaching a lot of people, persuading a lot of people. And yet the most effective persuasion really happens in a one-on-one discussion where one gets to understand where the other person is coming from, what their worldview is, what prior ideas and assumptions they bring in, and if they have reservations, where those reservations are coming from. And perhaps that will enable one to see how transhumanism can actually address those reservations in a nuanced and reasonable way as perceived by that other individual. So we need a lot more grassroots activism. We need a lot more people communicating these ideas. I've been opposed to any sort of rebranding of the transhumanist movement because it's been done before multiple times. And every time the result has been lackluster, because transhumanism, even though it doesn't yet have mainstream awareness, it does have a certain degree of awareness. There are many figures in academia, in the media, in politics even, who are aware of transhumanism. So there's some initial foundation. There is a decent amount of work that has been done to bring our movement to this particular level. It's just that an order of magnitude more work along the same lines will need to be done to bring it truly into the mainstream. But in terms of getting people to identify with transhumanism, yes, it's true that a purely reason-focused approach may not be enough to get some people on board. We had an excellent virtual enlightenment salon recently with Gary Abramson, who is a graphic designer among his many other talents, and he focused the discussion in that salon on the importance of inspiration, cultivating a vision of the future that people can look forward to. So it's not about, well, how do we call ourselves as a movement? It's not about necessarily even what language we use, what rhetoric we use. It's about creating that overall vision. And this is where artists, graphic designers, filmmakers, game creators, writers of fiction, writers of nonfiction manifestos, they can put their talents to work and create products that each inspire in their own way. Think of the fable of the dragon tyrant as a great example, a video that illustrated the fable of the dragon tyrant by Nick Bostrom had millions of views on YouTube because it's a story that really communicates the nature of the dilemma that we are experiencing right now with regard to aging and death, but in a way that's really accessible to people. So I don't think it should be about revising anything about transhumanism. This effort should be about creating a lot more new content that reaches different people, perhaps in different ways based on what they identify with, but each person should find something in this vast body of content that transhumanists should create that would serve as their gateway into our movement.
Okay. In the chat, David mentioned that it is necessary to involve and include not only insiders, but also outsiders. And we have one such outsider just coming on board. So Neven, you have the floor.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for the information and a lot of things that you have mentioned, like topics. I have two questions. One of them was about the, it's Again, basically, because I'm new in this kind of transhumanism things and everything. So just like how it can influence the global solutions towards the future, and like how this kind of movement could influence the all the events that you just mentioned in your presentation that is happening all around the world and these kind of things. And the second topic was about the vaccines in the United States. How is the situation? These are my questions.
So in terms of how transhumanism could influence future outcomes, certainly that could be a very broad subject of discussion. But think about how technologies have transformed everyday life, how computers, the internet, mobile phones have transformed life in recent memory, and apply that to other areas of emerging technology, for instance, biotechnology in medicine. Imagine how life would change if people could regenerate lost limbs or reverse aspects of their aging at a cellular level, or if they have a disability, cure that disability through a variety of innovative treatments. Or in a slightly more distant future, perhaps they could have nanobots patrolling their bloodstream and identifying any abnormalities and fixing them on the spot, or relaying real-time data about the organism to the individual so that people can monitor their condition in a very granular way. Or think about the achievements of private spaceflight recently and project that forward. Imagine the ability for people to be space tourists for the cost of an airplane ticket today. Or imagine large vertical farms in cities. Some of them are already being built that are able to ensure a consistent food supply from local sources to any number of inhabitants. Imagine a future of clean energy where humans don't have to rely on fossil fuels anymore, and there are many fewer substances emitted into the atmosphere that may be responsible for climate change. So imagine we reverse the problem of deleterious climate change. We have clean, safe, solar, hydroelectric, geothermal, nuclear energy instead. And there are many other areas of technological advancement that we could discuss here. But imagine also a society where instead of people thinking of politics or culture in terms of my side versus the other side, they think of solutions. They think of how do we address the problems that face all of the inhabitants of the society? How do we do that in a calm, rational, constructive manner without thinking about, well, does this benefit me or does this benefit my opponents? So those are some of the ways in which transhumanism can positively affect the future. Now, in terms of the situation with vaccination in the United States, a majority of the US population has been fully vaccinated at this stage, and another portion has been partially vaccinated. There is a wide disparity based on what state one looks at in terms of the vaccination rates. And there are parts of the country like the deep south of the United States where in certain states, still only a minority of the population is vaccinated. But the proportion of vaccinated individuals is rising gradually. I think with the emergence of this Delta variant, a lot more people are becoming concerned enough about catching COVID-19 that if they were kind of on the margin, hesitant to get the vaccine, but still open to the possibility, they're now going and getting the vaccines. I would say less than a fifth of the population, based on the surveys that I've seen, are resistant on principle to getting vaccinated. For a lot of the others, the sources of reluctance were a bit more pragmatic and perhaps temporary in nature, capable of being overcome. So that's the situation in the United States. Now, I understand in other countries, there may be more challenges. And even in the United States, there are challenges too. But I do remain hopeful that most people are going to see vaccination as the correct decision for them. And I do think a little bit more positive persuasion, inspiration can help get us to that point.
Okay, thank you. Other questions or comments to Gennady? If not, Gennady, thank you very much again.
Thank you. Thank you.